All right. Good morning, Springs Lighthouse.
Good morning, Pastor Scott.
Okay, I got a serious question. Does anybody else feel like it's too early for spring? Like, maybe? Is it just me? Yeah, I get some nods. So, like, silent majority. No. We welcome you guys. We have a few new faces in the congregation. I am Pastor Scott. I'm the assistant pastor. If you need restrooms, we got Kids Cove and women's restrooms over here, regular restrooms in the cafe. We are just excited to have everybody here. And for everybody who's always here, thank you for being here. We appreciate you guys. So we are going to stand. We're going to pray, and then we'll dive into our study today. Heavenly Father, we just come before you today to worship you, Lord. We want to rejoice in you and just hear what you have to say to us this morning. Feed us and nurture us in only the ways you can, Lord, and just have our souls just rejoice in you, Lord. Let us be in joy this morning for you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. How many of you are enjoying allergy season? All right, so you have to sing extra loud this morning because my voice is shot. But we can worship the Lord anyway. I intend to make a joyful noise. How about you?
Yeah.
All right.
You are good. You are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love. You are love. On display for all to see. You are light. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you are hope. You have covered all my sin. You are peace, you are peace.
When my fear is crippling,
you are true, you are true.
Even in my wandering,
you are joy, you are joy. That I sing, you are life, in you death has lost its sting.
Oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough, nothing compares.
step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship. So, Lord, here we are to worship. Father, to acknowledge that it is all about you, not about us. That worship is just a time to lift our hearts along with our praises to you. And to acknowledge who you are and all that you've done in our lives. So, Lord, this morning, as we continue in an attitude of worship, approaching your word, so many other different things that we need to do today, even in our time of announcements, Father, when we're talking about ministry opportunities and these kinds of things, Lord, may it be an act of worship to you.
because you are God and we are not. And we acknowledge that in this place this morning. We yield and we submit to you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, we're glad that you're here with us. If you're visiting, we would like to take a special opportunity to connect with you. And so as our ushers come down the aisle, they have connect cards in their hands. Let them know you need one, and they'll hand you one. You can fill it out and get it to us after the service. Drop it in an offering box. See one of us that looks like they half know what they're doing, and they're probably leadership. What else? Kids are dismissed to my right, to your left, to Kids Cove, and turn around and greet one another with the love of Jesus Christ. Well, again, am I on? There we go. There we go. Again, welcome to Allergy Chapel. Again, we do want to welcome you to Springs Lighthouse. I get to do one of my favorite things this morning, and that's to dedicate one of our young ones to the Lord. And so, Zeke, if you'll bring your mom up here. Where'd he go? Did he run off? Hey, buddy. How are you? Hey, look at all those people.
Yeah, look at everybody.
They're scary, aren't they?
No. But that, mister, is not the one.
Oh, okay. All right. So it was about 30 years ago that Zeke's mom was barely, you weren't even this old, you were little. Yeah, she was a baby, and I dedicated her to the Lord. So now she's working in the office. This is the Shaylin you always hear about that helps out in the office and does so much for us in there. And so what an honor it is for me to be able to dedicate little Zeke to the Lord. And can I pray for you? Yeah? It's okay? All right. All right, can I hold your hand? Okay, thanks, Zeke. Father, we thank you so much for these little ones that you bring into our midst. Lord, your word says that they are a joy and that they are a blessing. And Lord, I know that Ezekiel has been an incredible blessing to his mom, to his dad, to his big sister, and to the rest of the family. And Lord, I pray that as he grows, Lord, our prayer for him as he's dedicated to you this morning is that he would grow to know you, that he would grow in your strength, that he would grow in wisdom before you and in our presence. And Father, that we would commit to upholding his mom particularly as she seeks to raise him in a way that honors you. And Father, that you would bless their family abundantly in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Here you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Bye, Lily. If he's half the character that his sister is by Zeke, he is, oh man, you got your hands full, Shaylin. All right, I do have a couple more announcements for you. Many of you were aware that Janine and I were going to leave after second service and head straight down to San Antonio. My hope was to be able to get down there and see the eclipse, but my son and his family live in the same area, and so we were going to get to spend some time with him since his birthday is Wednesday. And then a number of different things happened that have changed our plans. So we will actually be in town most of the coming week. I am going to go down to Albuquerque because a good friend and ministry partner of mine passed away this week. And I'm heading down to that funeral down at Calvary Albuquerque. Some of you knew Chip Lusco and had some kind of contact with him. Kind of an interesting story. So Chip was the general manager of a radio station here in town when I first came to town in 1991 and took over the pastorate of a little church of 50 people known as Rocky Mountain Calvary. And so Chip, as the GM of the station, approached me. He also was pastoring a church here in town. And he said, hey, you need to come on the radio. That was the first experience I had with any kind of radio ministry, was through KCBR, as it was known at the time. And so Chip introduced me to all of the staff there, but the DJ at the time that I most clicked with was a gentleman named Chris Ward. Many of you know Chris because he was here teaching for me recently when I was on sabbatical. And it is Chris's son, Aaron, who is going to arrive here shortly on staff as our worship leader. So if not for Chip, that connection never would have been made. Now, we can do all the ins and outs and fry our brains over, well, God would have worked it out another way. But he didn't. He used Chip. And Chip was probably responsible for our second initial growth spurt at Rocky Mountain Calvary. We saw a little bit of a growth spurt when Focus on the Family moved to town and people that were familiar with Calvary Chapel's ministry. But then Chip said, you know, you're here. There's no reason for me to be here. And he went down to assist Skip Heitzig down at Calvary Albuquerque, closed down his church, and sent them all over to Rocky Mountain Calvary. And so, and they were a blessing to us. And so Chip has just been, he's been instrumental in my ministry and just being an encouragement to me. I think the last time I had breakfast with him was a couple of years ago down in Miami, and it was a blessing to see him. He recently passed away from pancreatic cancer. We thought that he was responding really well to the chemo, and then all of a sudden just took a turn, and the Lord took him home. He's good, but the rest of us, of course, are sitting here missing him. And so my wife and I will be heading out after service today to head down there to Albuquerque to be at his funeral tomorrow. And I've postponed my trip to go see my son. And besides, I was watching the weather report, and they said it's supposed to be cloudy in San Antonio, and I wouldn't have been able to see the eclipse anyway. Almost like God had a plan, right? Almost like God said, it's going to be cloudy. You can't go see the eclipse, so go to Chip's funeral. So, okay, I'll do that, Lord. So pray for us as we head down there. Pray for the family that's grieving. Many of you might be more familiar with his son Levi Lusco's ministry up in Montana. And so just a lot of grief there on the family side. A couple of other announcements for you. Ladies' Night Out is Tuesday, April 16th, ladies. That's at 6 p.m. at On the Border Mexican Grill. So we encourage you ladies to come on out and join the other ladies just for a time of fellowship. It's a great time to get to know folks, great time to just encourage other ladies. So ladies, come on out for that. Tuesday, April 16th, 6 p.m. On the Border Mexican Grill. Also for the ladies, the Wise Woman Getaway is coming up. This is the last weekend to register. Okay, I know how you folks are. This is the last weekend to register, which is the weekend most of you have been waiting for. So please stop by the table over here to my right, to your left, the getaway table, and there will be ladies over there to answer any of the questions that you may have. The getaway itself is April 19th through the 21st. They can help you get it all set up to attend. It's at the Hideaway Inn and Conference Center up in Black Forest. I've been getting a lot of questions about this. So this is not the main focal point of the retreat and the getaway. It's to spend time with ladies. It's to spend time with the Lord. It's to spend time getting your heart in a position to receive from the Lord. But a couple of us will be going up and running a shooting range for the ladies. So you'll get more information on that when you register. And so bring your pistols up there, your sidearms, and we will be taking you through a time of shooting during your free time on Saturday. Welcome brunch for the Ward family. Aaron and his family, his wife Emily, and their little one Levi, who's 1 year old, will be arriving in town the week of the 15th. I think they get into town on the 17th, and they're going to unload their trailer into their apartment on the 18th. If you're able to help out during the day on the 18th, we need a couple of folks to help them unload the trailer and get moved into their apartment. See Pastor Scott or contact the church office, and Pastor Scott will let you know what's needed and where. And then we are going to have a welcome, I'm calling it the Ward Welcome Wagon, or W-Cubed, and we are going to do that on Saturday, April 27th at 10 a.m. So it's kind of a brunch just to welcome them to the area. They're moving from Prescott, Arizona. Welcome them into town and to our fellowship. So 10 o'clock Saturday, April 27th, we'll be in the galley. We'll be out here. Bring a dish to share, kind of potluck style, and we'll just be a blessing to them. Also, our intention is next weekend, to have over in the Beacon a list of items that they need. They're a young couple. It's very different when you move when you're young. Amen? When you move when you're young, you just don't have a lot of stuff. When you move at my age, you got lots of stuff. And so they're not coming in with a lot. There are some things that they could use for their apartment, and we want to be a blessing to them. That's our desire. We know they're going to be a blessing to us and leading us in worship, but we want to bless them as well. So we'll have a list of items that they are in need of that you can pick up over at the Beacon after service next week. Jimmy will be serving barbecue stuff after second service. So for those of you that are also serving and helping out next service, there will be food available for purchase after second service. And I think that's it, other than to say that our spotlight on missions for this month is Leona Carney. Many of you know Leona. She's been here a number of times. Older gal that just runs circles around almost everyone I know with her level of energy and what God allows her to do. Is she approaching 80 at this point? Approaching 80 years old, and right now is in South America, bumping around from country to country down there and ministering. It's phenomenal. She is the first missionary that every church I have pastored has supported. And so I just make it a point that everywhere I go, she goes with me as far as support. So we'd support her as a ministry here. And she's based out of Las Vegas now because she's not able to be on the field full time, but she still just bounces all the time to wherever the Lord calls her, and it's amazing to watch. So pray for her this month. We want to spotlight her and be able to lift her up before the Lord in prayer for strength and for safety. So Hebrews chapter 4, if you'd turn there, please, and we will pray before we jump in. Father, we thank you that you are a God who desires to speak to his people. And so, Lord, knowing that your heart is to speak to us, we come with an attitude of humility before you, and yet, along with the humility, a certain boldness to be able to approach you, to know with assurance that you will speak to your people if we would have ears to hear. And so, Lord, grant us those ears to hear. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. We specifically lift up Leona to you this morning. We ask that you would minister to her and bless her on the mission field, and that she would be a blessing to those to whom she ministers. Father, we pray for the Lusco family, and we ask, Lord, that you would remind us during the service tomorrow of his legacy, but Lord, in a way that you remain the hero, because Jesus is the hero, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Hebrews chapter 4, we came as far as verse 12. And so that's, of course, where we will ultimately pick up our text and begin our study today. But just a quick review, the author of Hebrews is encouraging his readers, and his readers would be Jewish Christians in that first century. We're probably before the destruction of the temple, so that dates the letter to pre-70 AD, because it was in 70 AD that the temple was torn down. There are some clues within the text that seem to indicate that the sacrifices were still continuing. If the sacrifices were continuing, then the temple was standing. So this must have been written before 70 AD. That means that the early church is in existence, but it is almost predominantly consists of Jewish believers, Jews who have come to faith in Christ. The gospel has begun to go out to the Gentiles, but its greatest effect at this point has been upon Hebrew Christians. So now we have this group of Hebrew Christians who is facing suffering. And because of the suffering they're experiencing, and you remember this was not really from the Roman government, not yet. Rome has not yet begun to crack down on Christians. The suffering they're experiencing is from their fellow Jews, is from their countrymen, those who do not accept Jesus as the promised Messiah or Christ. And so it's costing them jobs. It's costing them relationships. They're losing their homes and their property. They're being kicked out of society, basically, because of their faith in Christ. And so because some of them are at a place of saying, well, maybe I can hold on to my faith in Jesus as the Messiah. I can still believe and trust that he is our Savior, but I can go back under the system of the old covenant. Because there I will at least, with all the trappings of the old covenant and observing Sabbath and kosher and the feasts and all of these things, then I won't be experiencing so much persecution from my countrymen. And the author is encouraging them to stay the course, to press on in the midst of their suffering, not to go back to a system where they were trying to attain righteousness by what they did, but staying in a place where they accept and embrace the righteousness that comes only through Jesus Christ. So that's why the book has been written. In this particular section, we have been talking about rest. So the author brings us to this idea that God has promised rest to his people. And through different courses of their history, they thought, well, the promised rest must be the Sabbath. And we've already discussed why that rest was not just the Sabbath. The Sabbath rest prefigured or pictured a coming rest. Well, then that rest must be the promised land. No, because there were still battles and giants in the promised land. Right? How many of you have heard that the promised land is a picture of heaven? Right? We're going to cross over Jordan and go to the promised land. That's a picture of heaven. Listen, when I get to heaven, I am not anticipating giants and battles. Amen? No, that's a place where the battles are done. We rest. So there was a future rest still that was promised. And the author has been laying out that rest is found in Jesus Christ. Not in the Sabbath, not in the land of Israel. The rest is found in Jesus Christ. And so he's encouraging them, you need to find rest in your salvation. Aren't you glad God has given us rest? Three of you are glad that God has given us rest. Let me put this a little differently and see if this helps. How many of you are glad when you came here today and came through these doors, you weren't carrying a dove or a lamb or dragging a cow through these doors to have to sacrifice it here today? Oh, yeah, there we go. Right now we're happy. Yes, okay, if you put it that way, thank you, God, for the rest we have in Jesus Christ. And aren't you glad to worship this morning with God's people? We didn't have to go to Israel. I love Israel. I love going to Israel. I love leading other people over to Israel to see the land. But I'm so glad that worship of God is not confined to Israel or to any location, really. That's the kind of rest we have, that we can approach him anywhere. But when we want to gather with his people, we gather here without having to drag sacrifices in here. What a mess that would be if we started slaughtering bulls and goats right here. I think God's paging us. Or that maybe that's some lamb's collar going off over there. I'm not sure. I mean, can you imagine what that would be like? We don't have to do that anymore. Because the perfect Lamb of God was slain for us. And we get to rest in that. So in verse 11, the writer said, let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. And the example he was giving to us is that Israel as a nation, when they came into the promised land, they entered into a rest of sorts. It wasn't the fulfillment of God's promised rest that's found in Jesus. It was, however, a picture, a prefiguring of what God would do through Jesus. But when they came to the land the first time, did they go in? No, they turned away. Why? Because of unbelief. They turned away because of unbelief. Yeah, the land looks good, the spies said, but 10 of them said, we'll never conquer that land. There's giants in the land. They'll eat our children. We can't take it. Only two of the spies, Joshua and Caleb, said, we can do this. God's on our side. But the 10 turned the entire nation around, and for 40 years they wandered in the wilderness and did not enter into that land that God had promised them. Why? Unbelief. Unbelief. Not trusting God. And the reason I'm going back over this is it becomes really important to our context of what we're looking at this morning. They are used in Hebrews, the children of Israel are used in Hebrews as an example that unbelief prevents us from entering into the rest that God has for us. So let's explore that a little bit more. Because he says this in verse 12, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now, most of you, if you've been a Christian for over a month, have probably heard this verse before. We use it a lot, and we use it in a lot of ways. Most of the ways in which we use it are really good, and they're a clear and true interpretation of the verse. But in the context of what's being said here in Hebrews chapter 4, he's saying, here's why we must not shrink back, why we must continue to trust God, why we must continue to press forward rather than to pull back in unbelief. There's no place for unbelief when we truly understand the power that is available in the Word of God in which we are called to trust. Amen? This Word of God that we are studying this morning, it's alive. It is powerful. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. And what he's saying is that it is more powerful than any instrument of war devised by man up to that day. The sword, the Roman sword, that double-edged sword. And because God's word is that powerful, gang, we can trust it. We can stand upon it. So here's what happens. And I know this is going to be a little uncomfortable for most of us. It should be a little uncomfortable maybe for all of us because we all wrestle with this. When we are not at rest, when we're stressing out, it's because we've left off trusting in God and the things that he said to us. And if your initial reaction is, well, I'm not sure that's true, I don't want to hear it after service. Please don't come and talk to me. Just go home. Get on your face, suck some carpet, and cry out to God and ask him. Because I have found, and listen, I'm not saying this as someone who's got this conquered. I spend way too much of my time stressed out. It's part of my nature sometimes, I think, to be stressed out. I can hide it fairly well most of the time. My wife's like, you can? When I'm out of the house, I can hide it pretty well. But I spend a lot of time stressed out, and when I stop and think, wait a minute, what's been one of our theme statements for this year? God's got this. It's when I stop remembering that God's got this that I start getting stressed out. So we're in a political season. We have any political junkies here along with me? Yeah? Okay. Everybody's like, no, I'm not raising my hand. That'll stress me out. We get stressed out over this stuff. And it's because we're not trusting that God's got this. So that means my guy will get elected? No, it does not. Not necessarily. It means that no matter who occupies the Oval Office, they ain't got this. God's got this. So I can trust in God's word where he says that he elevates people to those positions, no matter that, we do our responsibility to go and to vote. We have that opportunity in this country that God has blessed us with. I think that every Christian should vote. And we don't need to argue over that. There's no command in the Bible, thou shalt vote. Okay, so let's be clear about that. That's my personal belief. Christians need to be engaged, but ultimately, God's got this. Is our country going in a weird direction right now? Yeah. I don't care your political persuasion. Because I don't think it has a whole lot to do ultimately with who's in the office as much as it does with the hearts of our nation. And when we get to a point that women in Colorado Springs, this happened, when you can't go into a gym locker room and have the expectation you're not going to see a nude dude walking through there, that's a problem. That is a problem. Women should feel safe in that environment. And they don't. But God's got this. So we can write our letters and we can make our phone calls. We can do all of that stuff, but not from a position that's stressed out. Because that shows that we're struggling with a lack of unbelief. And when we struggle with that unbelief, we need to go back to the Word of God and remember, this Word is living and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. And it is able to pierce even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. In that day, the sword was the most trusted, pervasive, and deadly instrument that a Roman soldier relied on. Now, they had other weapons. They had bows and arrows, and they had lances, and they had catapults and all of these sorts of things that they could utilize, and battering rams and all of this. But the most trusted and reliable weapon that that soldier had was his sword, probably akin to a patrolman's firearm, his sidearm, right? It was always there, always ready. He was trained to use it. And because it was double-edged, two-edged, it means that it could cut this way or that way. There was not a dull edge on that sword. And those Roman soldiers knew how to use them. Spurgeon says this, in every part, because he's comparing the Word of God to that sword, he says the Word of God is in every part keen to cut the conscience and wound the heart. That's the Word of God. And this is not the only place we see this illustration. When Paul writes to the Ephesian church in chapter 6, he tells them to take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. When we look into the book of Revelation, when John sees the glorified Jesus, one of the things he says in his description of Jesus is, out of his mouth went a sharp, two-edged sword. Now that sword represents God's word coming forth from his mouth. And when you get into Revelation 2 and 3, we see this clearly. So the word of God likened to a sword. Why? Because, gang, Can we be honest today and say, sometimes the Word of God cuts me. Sometimes the Word of God wounds me. But it does so necessarily to show me where I need something cut out of my life. Whether it's an action or an attitude or anything else, when God says, I'm going to do surgery on this thing in your life, sometimes it's not pretty. Agreed? Surgical units are seldom pretty. And so when God begins to cut this stuff out of our life, it becomes transformative for us because he reaches even to the place of our soul and spirit inside, the way that a Roman sword would cut to joint and marrow, coming to a place of drawing out even the thoughts and intents of a man's heart. And I love that. Because it's more than just the actions. Going to the thoughts and intents of a person's heart. Not only the what, but the why. Not just the actions outwardly, but the motivations behind them. Because sometimes our good actions can have bad motivations, can't they? And see, God even gets in there to deal with that. Some of you are saying right now, well, this is kind of making me uncomfortable. Don't falter in unbelief. Trust God that his word says he is good, amen? That he loves you, amen? So then if he's going to cut you and wound you with his word, does he have a good purpose for it? I know the thoughts I have for you, says the Lord, to give you a future and a hope, thoughts of good and not of evil. That's our God. Now, watch this interesting transition. Verse 13, There is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Well, now that's interesting. There is no creature hidden from his sight. Whose sight? Well, now we know we're talking about God's sight, correctly? Correct? Sorry. I'm really laboring to get through my voice going away. We know that it's talking about God's sight, that there's nothing hidden from his sight, but we weren't talking about a person. In verse 12, we were talking about the word of God, weren't we? We were talking about the logos, the written word of God. But we get into verse 13, and what does the writer do? The writer personifies the written word. Interesting. He personifies the written word. The word of God is living and powerful and active and is sharper than any two-edged sword. And it gets down into there to discern even the thoughts and intents of the heart. And then there is no creature hidden from his sight. Grammatically, without a personification, that should say there is no creature hidden from its sight, the word's sight. And yet the word is a person. The word is Jesus. And this isn't the only place in the scripture we see this, is it? John chapter 1, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And it goes on to talk about the fact that he was in the beginning with God, all things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. Do you see what John has just done? In the beginning was the Word, he, and he's personified the Word. And in verse 14 of John chapter 1, he makes it really clear what he is saying. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. It's Jesus that is the Word of God. He is the personification of the Word of God. Revelation chapter 19, verse 13. John sees Jesus, and he says he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. So all of the scripture agrees. The Word of God is personified in the person of Jesus. So here's what the author is saying in these verses in the context of not losing sight of the rest we have in Jesus Christ. Our lives are transparent. They are laid bare before the living Word, and they are brought out. Our lives are brought into that transparency by the written Word. The written Word of God lays our lives out so that the living Word of God sees them. And when we are operating in unbelief, you know, we can tell ourselves we're not. I have reason to be stressed out. Okay. There's a lot of stressful things. There are a lot of stressful things that are happening right now. Well, then I have reason to be stressed. Not if you really trust that God's got this. Not when we really trust that God's got this. And please, please, please hear me again. I am not saying this as somebody that's got this handled. I'm saying this as someone that hates to teach this stuff. Because it pierces me when I realize how far short I still fall. But here's what I do know. I can be honest with God when I'm struggling with unbelief, when I'm wrestling with trusting him, and I want to be stressed out. I can be honest with him about it. Why? Because the written word obviously already reveals this about me. The living word sees this in my life. So why would I try to hide it? Why do we try to hide stuff from God? I mean, think about it. Isn't that ridiculous? Do we think God doesn't see it? Like we're going to hide it and God's like, what's that behind your back? No, God sees it all. Here's a better plan. Confess it. Let him deal with it and go back to the place of rest and just trusting in him. What a freeing thing when even when we struggle in our unbelief, that we let God work on that unbelief, cutting it out of our lives. It's like the man who said to Jesus, I believe, Lord, help me in my unbelief. How many of us are like that? Like, Lord, I believe, I know that you can do this. I've got it all up here. But that distance from here to here is like super big. So I believe, but help me in my unbelief where I still struggle and wrestle. So now we get into verse 14, and the author takes us in a direction that's going to occupy a large portion of the rest of this letter. He says in verse 14, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession." Remember, we were talking about this in our introduction. This is why the author writes the letter. Hold fast your confession in Jesus Christ, the author of the new covenant. The new covenant is better than the old covenant. You don't need to live by the old covenant anymore because Jesus has fulfilled it, right? So let's hold fast to that confession. Why? Because we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Now, he's going to go on to address a number of different things that we'll study in coming weeks, having to deal with, again, what I've said before. Jesus is better than. He's better than the Aaronic priesthood. He's better than the Levitical priesthood. He's better than the worship system in the tabernacle and the temple. He's better than the old covenant because he's ushered in a new covenant. And all of these things we'll discuss in coming weeks. But we begin with this statement that we have a great high priest. And he clearly tells us who that great high priest is, Jesus, the Son of God. And we need to stop for a moment. Because we hear this as a predominantly Gentile church living 2,000 years later, and it doesn't impact us the same way that it would hit the Hebrew mind. The Jewish mind, when he hears about a high priest, has a way to contextualize that that we've never seen and lived under. They had a system of worship that included a high priest. And so when they hear that term, specific questions would come to mind. You're saying that Jesus is our great high priest? Well, that's clearly what verse 14 says. Amen? We can all see it. This is one of the great things about verse-by-verse study. I'm not just telling you something. It's right there. Jesus is this great high priest. The Jewish mind would stop and say, wait a minute. Jesus is from which tribe? Judah. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is a descendant specifically of what great king? David, from the lineage of Judah. The priests came from what tribe? Levi. That's not the tribe of Judah. In order to be a priest, you had to have Levi genes. Oh, I get it. So, some of you will get it on the way home. So you had to come through the tribe of Levi, but Jesus didn't come through the tribe of Levi. How then can he be our great high priest? We're going to address that in chapter 5. We'll address it even in more detail in chapter 7. It deals with the fact that there is a different order of priesthood. So because, and I address this morning because some of you would immediately go there in your minds. And I want to just make sure that you understand that God does, through the writer of Hebrews, address this question. How can Jesus be our great high priest if he's not from the tribe of Levi? When the priesthood was first instituted, it was not a Levitical priesthood. It was an Aaronic priesthood. Because Moses' brother Aaron was appointed by God to be the first high priest, and his sons served alongside of him as priests. It wasn't until later that God ordained that the priesthood would come specifically through the tribe of Levi. So once Aaron and his sons were gone, there would continue to be a priesthood, but it would now be a Levitical priesthood. That's where we get these terms. What the writer of Hebrews is going to go on and say is that there's another order that supersedes not only the Levitical priesthood, but even the Aaronic priesthood. It is through the order of Melchizedek. So it is a Melchizedekian priesthood. And it gets a little bit wonky, and we'll go through all of that, and I'll try not to make it tedious. But we'll get more into this in our next chapter and then on into chapter 7. And you don't need to wait for me. You can read ahead, just not now, because we're still here. So we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens. So the author is developing something here for us. This is why our great high priest Jesus is so much better than the priesthood that existed even in the day that he was writing this. See, the tabernacle, when the tabernacle was constructed, Moses was told very specifically by God, you make it exactly like I tell you. Why was that? Because the tabernacle was designed to be a model, if you will, of the heavenly scene. If you study the tabernacle and how it's laid out, it is what we will expect to find when we get to heaven and stand before the throne of God. When you look at the book of Revelation, what John sees and describes, take it back and overlay it on the tabernacle. That basin, the basin for washing, and the sea of glass that John sees before the throne. All of these pieces fit together perfectly. So the high priest, in this day that Hebrews was written, would pass through the model of the heavenly scene. He says, Jesus didn't pass through the model. Jesus has actually passed through the portals of heaven. That was his eternal dwelling place. He has walked its halls. He has sat in the presence of the Father. I mean, all of this is saying our high priest is better. So don't go back under that old system. It's been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. God didn't just toss the old system. He had Jesus, the Son of God, God the Son, fulfill it for us so that we now live under this new covenant. 4, verse 15, we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Now, I find this to be important, because I see so much in the church today that is not like this. And here's what I mean. He says our great high priest, Jesus Christ, is not one that cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. In the old covenant, the high priest mediated between God and man, didn't he? He really did. Once a year, he could go into the most holy place, the Holy of Holies, taking the blood of the sacrifice in with him on behalf of the people. So it was the innocent substitute's life given on behalf of the nation, the blood poured into a basin, the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies that one day that was a very clear and strict appointed day, and he would go in and he would offer an offering before the Lord for the sins of the people. That was mediating on behalf of the people to God. He would then come forth from the presence of God, and he would tell the people the things that God wanted him to speak to the people. So he went to God on behalf of the people. He went to the people on behalf of God. That's a mediator. This was the job of the high priest. He was a man, a human being, going to God on behalf of the people, to the people on behalf of God. Being a man, he was sinful, correct? The high priest was sinful. He was a sinful man. You know why he was a sinful man? Because there's no other kind. So we know he was a sinful man. And God's intention was, because he was a sinful man himself, mediating for sinful men and women, he ought to have a certain level of understanding and sympathy and compassion on people who are stuck and wrestling in their own sinful condition. Because he knew his own. But that wasn't happening in Jesus' day, was it? It wasn't happening in the days of the book of Acts, was it? No, it's a group of religious leaders that had set themselves on a pedestal where they were better than everyone else because their attainment of righteousness was higher than anyone else's. And that's sad. That's sad because they should have been able to sympathize with the people, and they weren't. So when this writer says, we don't have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, that was a poke in the eye of the high priest of that day. Our high priest gets us. He does. He understands us. He knows our frailties. He knows that we're made of dust because he was tempted just like we are, yet he was without sin. He knows what it means to resist sin right up to the very end and never succumb to it. He was tempted as we are, yet without sin. He became man to experience our temptations, yet never succumbing to them. He knows what it is like to resist and resist and resist and never give in all the way up to the time that he's resurrected and glorified and taken into heaven. See, we don't know that, do we? We don't know what that looks like. We resist and resist and resist until we finally give in. That's how our life goes, because we struggle with our humanity and with our frailty. He understands that. And that's why we have verse 16, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may." And that word "may" is not in the sense of maybe, it's in the sense of shall. "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may or shall obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." So I'll ask you the question. And you don't need to answer it out loud. You don't need to raise your hand. Do we have confidence in approaching God? My answer would be, I should. I mostly do. But do we also have those times when we're kind of maybe even afraid to approach God? Or maybe we shrink back because we feel guilty? Like, Pastor, I can't just boldly approach God because my week has been terrible. My year has been terrible. I had a bad year yesterday with my sinful condition and giving in to temptation, and I'm just such a wretched man, or I'm such a wretched woman. And the enemy's constantly whispering in our ear, God can't love you after what you did. God can't use you after what you've done. Look at you. You're detestable. You're despicable. The only answer to Satan when he's doing that to you is to say, you're right, but God. But God says, I can boldly approach the throne of grace. See, if you're not boldly approaching the throne of grace, why is that? Unbelief. You're not believing what it says right here. Listen, if I said this to you and God had not said it, I would consider myself a heretic. But God says it. You get to boldly approach his throne. That does not mean arrogantly. It does not mean impudently. I'm just going to march right in there and tell God what's on my mind. Yeah, you do that. And stand by. Because like Job, he's going to correct you. But you can boldly come before his throne because he loves you. And he has made a way for you to obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In fact, it seems to me the more needy we're feeling at the moment by this verse, that's the time we really need to come boldly to the throne of grace. And here's the problem. In the temple, that veil that kept man from God, it was a representation of our sin. Our sinful condition. That was what stood between us and God. That veil that the high priest could only enter through once a year. Josephus tells us, I believe it was Josephus, that says that it was at least 4 inches thick. And that it was 70 feet tall. Arnold wasn't going to grab that thing. Arnold wasn't going to grab that thing from the bottom and rip that in two. But when Jesus died, it was torn in two from the top to the bottom, the scripture specifically says. In other words, God tore it in two. He ripped it apart. He says, you now have access to my presence through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. You can boldly come before the throne of grace. Amen? Amen. Listen, if this doesn't excite you, your wood's wet. If this doesn't cause you to burn and a fire to burn in you, your wood is wet. We have access to the Father. But here's the problem. Jesus dies, the veil is torn in two, and yet we know that sacrifices continued until 70 AD. You know what that means? Someone sewed it back together. Don't let anyone sew that veil back together in your life. There's one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. And because of him, we have access to the Father. to his goodness and to his grace. And that door is wide open. The scripture says so right here. Whenever we shrink back from that, it's because we're letting something get in the way of us simply trusting what God has spoken. And there's such a great illustration of this that goes way back to the very beginning of the scripture. Before the fall, before sin entered into the world, Adam and Eve, the scripture says, were naked and were unashamed. They were naked and unashamed. Why? Because there was just complete freedom. There was complete vulnerability, and it didn't bother them because they didn't know any better, because they only knew good. The problem with eating of the tree of good and evil was that they didn't know evil. They only knew good. So what their eyes were open to was evil when they sinned against the commandment of God. And at that moment when they sinned, they realized their nakedness. And so what did they do? They set out to cover their nakedness their way. And so they go from being naked and unashamed to naked and afraid. Long before there was the TV show. And they sew together, what does the scripture say? Fig leaves. Fig leaves. So I Googled fig leaves. And I found a description of a fig leaf. This is from the website specialtyproduce.com. I know, it just sounds so weird. Pastor Brian was on the website specialtyproduce.com. Yes, I was, for this reason. Here's the description of the fig leaf. The top of the leaf is rough and sandpaper-like, while the bottom of the leaf has small, stiff hairs. So let's ask the obvious question. Does this sound like something you want to make a loincloth out of? Does this sound to you like something you want to wear as underwear? Okay, can we be real this morning? No, this sounds like a rash. That's what this sounds like. And you can expect a rash to be the least of the consequences of trying to cover the result of your sin by yourself. So what does God do? Well, God comes to the garden. He draws them to a place of confession, deals with their sin, and clothes them. You say, well, wait a minute. He also made sure that he put them out of the garden and he blocked the way to the tree of life. And that was the most merciful thing God could have done. How tragic had they made their way to the tree of life and eaten of it and had to live eternally in this fallen, sinful condition in these bodies. Thank you, God, for that mercy. He blocked the way to the tree of life. They confessed their sin, he dealt with their sin, and he clothed them. But even that's interesting to look at, because specifically the scripture says the Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed them. The Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed them. Now, God could have clothed them any way that he desired. He could have made a cotton polyester garment for them. He didn't do that. It says he made tunics of skin for them. That would require the death of an animal to have the skin to clothe them. The life of an innocent substitute was taken in order to cover the sinful condition of the guilty. In the very first sin, we already see God laying out the principle of substitutionary atonement. Is this amazing? It's astounding to me. It's almost like God had a plan. And of course he did. And he begins laying it out in ways that will always point to the coming of the one who would fulfill this plan, Jesus. The best part of his plan, the hero of his plan, and our hero today. So Father, thank you. Thank you for the plan that you had in mind before man ever committed the first sin. And Lord, there is so much about that we confess not understanding. But what we do understand, we're going to grab hold of. And that is that our sin separated us from you, and you made a way for our sin to be forgiven and paid for and taken out of the way so that we can boldly approach your throne of grace this morning. And so, Lord, we do so. In obedience to your command, we approach your throne this morning. In all of the craziness of our lives, we approach you and we lay it at your feet. We only want to carry that burden that Jesus desires for us to carry, and nothing more. Lord, thank you for the rest that is found in him. Father, thank you for the acknowledgement that we can make that you are a God who loves us and cares for us, and that we can simply put our faith and trust in you, just like children in the hands of their dad. We cry out to you, Abba, Father, today, as we approach your throne. And Lord, for any who have not yet made that determination, that decision to trust in Jesus, may this be the moment that right where they're sitting, they simply say, Lord, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. And I believe that you provided a Savior in the person of Jesus. And I believe that his death paid the price for my sin. And I believe that his resurrection from the dead proved that he conquered over sin and death. For me. And Father, for each of us then, minister to our hearts as we take communion together. Minister to us as we worship you together, and then as we fellowship together. And God, just simply bless your people. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me, please? We're going to invite you to the communion table as we do nearly every week here. An opportunity to take of the bread and remember Jesus' body broken for us, to take of the cup and remember his blood that was shed for us. And if you're visiting with us, again, a reminder, I'll say this every week, those of you that are here every week, it might seem tedious to you, but I think it's important. This is not just for Springs Lighthouse members or people that attend here. This is the Lord's table, not our table. And he invites you, if you want to remember Jesus today, that you come. So come, take the elements, take them back to your seat as we continue to worship. Take them when you're ready, and we'll just continue to lift up our Lord and Savior in this place for another few moments. Amen? All right, so you come, and let's worship together.
Called me out upon the waters, the great unknown. The feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, an ocean steep. My faith will stand. Call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours. You are. Abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. I fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed and you won't start now. I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, like a sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, like a sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, like a sweet, sweet song.
Father, you are the one that we worship. You're the one to whom we sing. Father, bless your people, encourage them, strengthen them. Lord, thank you that we can approach your throne boldly. Lord, may we proclaim your name boldly. As we leave this place and go outside of these walls into the mission field you've prepared for us, Lord, may we honor and glorify you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you guys. Have a fantastic remainder of your weekend.